Hello everyone and welcome to something else that's new for this channel. So a few of my friends will know that I have been flying on Flight Sim for many, many years now, but actually it's never once featured on my YouTube channel, mostly because I've had a lot of trouble trying to record it. But now I think I'm finally in a position to be able to do so. And actually, I've not been flying in a very, very long time. So, this is basically my reintroduction to Flight Sim. I think this is going to be literally the first flight I have done in close to 2 years. So, I am flying, let me go back into the outside view. I am flying this here, the de Havilland Twin Otter, which is presented to you by Aerosoft. That's who made this mod. We are flying from Cumbernauld Airport. This is also a mod, which I'll talk about later. And we are simulating our flight with passengers using FSPassengersX, which is what this thing is over at the top right. Now, I don't know if this is going to turn up in video. I can see from here that the lettering is a bit, how'd you call it? It's as if it's not set at the proper resolution, so that's a bit of an issue, but I can still read it, so it's not a big deal. And it's saying that we cannot board because the doors are closed, so let us fix that. So the doors are opening, we are going to start with the checklist. Now, obviously you can't see this because I am focusing on this here video game, but I do have on my iPad in front of me, I have my checklist of things that we need to run through. Right, okay. So, let's make a start. So, the parking brake is in. We've got that sorted. The fire T-handles, which are these you pull to extinguish fires, they are both in, which is fine. Standby fuel pumps in the normal position, which is fine. Normal fuel pumps in the off position, which is fine. Fuel selector should be normal, which it is. Sorry, I got distracted by the sound of the passengers boarding the plane. Avionics master switch should be in the off position, which it is now. Propeller de-icer, that's this one back up here, that is in the off position, which is fine. Cabin lights and signs, this is a no smoking flight, so this is, we're going to flick that on. When we get to starting the engines, we will put this on. This aircraft isn't fully cold, because actually at the time where I fired the sim up, I didn't actually do a flight. I literally just wanted to switch the engines off, because by default they start with engines on. I literally just switched what I could remember off. Oh, I'm lost. Right, so I've not... there might be some little things that crop up every now and again, but yeah, that's fine. So the beacon light, which I just switched off, we're going to switch back in. Yes, right, okay, that's fine. The PTOT heat is in the off position, which is fine. Generator switches are off. Now, it does have a list of things that aren't modelled on this. It says that this here, the busty switch, should be set into the normal position, but actually, I don't know if you can hear me furiously clicking, this isn't modelled. So, anyway, moving back on. This will be so much better when I get my ease dock camera back on. Flap handle in the up position, which it is. Fuel levers should now be in the full off position. Propeller levers in full forward. They probably should have been fully back, but for startup they should be fully forward. And this should be in the flight idle position, which it now is at about 10 to 15%. So Bear with me one little second. Right, it took a little minute there because my joystick was not behaving. I do have a flight yoke and pedals, but actually I've hurt my foot at the moment, so I don't fancy trying to work the rudder pedals with only one foot. So I'm just using my joystick because that has everything integrated into the hands. Right, windshield wipers are quite clearly off, that's fine. Landing lights should be in the off position, which they are, that's fine. Ignition switch, normal. Battery master switch, which is not that, that's the battery master. Should now be in the on position. We're going to check that we have voltage, which we do, that's grand. Caution lights, we've got some on, but we're going to check them properly, which is this one. Okay. So, yes, all the lights are on and they're working, which is great. And now they're back to normal. Marker beacon lights. Oh, I think I need the avionics on for that. Let's just put them on. Yeah, there we go. Right, okay. So, they are now working, which is fine. Beta range, let's use the throttle to take it out of beta range and we can test that they're working, and now they're on. So, all the passengers have boarded, so we will shut over the doors and we'll continue on with our checklist. We don't have the ability to detect fires, so moving on. Fuel quantity. We do indeed have fuel. That's, let's just zoom in a little bit. Yes, okay, so I set fuel at about 60%, so that's about fine. Now here's where we get to the fun part. We need to test, make sure the crossfeed is working. So let's put the boost on, and we are now going to crossfeed to forward. So boost on, off. So it should be one-sided, which is fine. Now do it the other way. Boost on, that's the other side, which is fine. And now we're going to go to normal. So off, 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 and we should have four lights, which we do. Great. Yeah, we're just hearing the radio there of aircraft flying around on, well, taxiing around on the airport, which is fine. Now we need to do the standby pump checks. So we're going to set all of these into the on position. And we are going to set off the aft boost pump. Oh, I've screwed something up because that's not right. No. Ah, yes, I remember this from before. No. Right, this is the one that should be off. So, yes, we do have our one light. Okay, and now we do it to the other side. And we have our one warning light, which is fine. So, let's put standby pumps off. And both normal pumps are on. So, that's fine. So now that the pre-starting checklists have been done, we are going to speak to Tower.
Tower, Havilland Golf, Bravo, Victor, Kilo, IFR, Echo, Charlie, ready to copy. The Havilland Golf, Bravo, Victor, Kilo, is cleared to Echo, Golf, Echo, Charlie, airport, is filed. Fly runway heading, climb and maintain 10,000. Departure frequency is 1190.1, squawk 0223.
Excellent.
Havilland Golf, Bravo, Victor, Kilo, cleared to Echo, Golf, Echo, Charlie, airport, is filed. Fly runway heading, climb and maintain 10,000. Departure on 1190.1, squawk 0223. The Havilland, Victor, Kilo, read back correct. Contact ground on 120.6.
Okay, so, we are going to start. How'd you know? We're going to push back a little bit. If I parked this myself, but I loaded it in a parking bay, so I'm pretty close to this here shed. so we're going to push back a little bit and then start our engines. Now, before we do that, I'm going to slightly deviate away from this. I'm actually going to, I don't know if you'll be able to see this, add on, I'm going to check what my weather is. Okay, yes, it does show me that. So, closest station. Altimeter 1019, which is fine. So, close that window. Great, and I'm going to hide the menu bar again. Try again. There we go. Right, okay. So,
Altimeter 1019, set and check.
So what you're hearing here is the virtual co-pilot that comes with FS Passengers. So that's him setting the various things, saves us having to do it, and for the giggles...
Heading 260, set and check.
Okay, so, let us tell our passengers to get the seatbelts on. I can see they're now doing that, and what we are going to do is... Oh yeah, no, we were going to push back a little bit.
Piper, Romeo, Lima, Victor, cleared to land, runway 26.
That would help if the parking brake was not.
Piper, Romeo, Lima, Victor.
So we'll push back to probably about here, I think that's okay. And I'm going to put the parking brake back on. And we're going to go back in here, and we are going to start our engines. So fuel boost has no warning light, so that's checked. So we're going to start our right-hand engine first, that's the left. Right. Okay, so what we're looking for... Oil pressure... Should be rising, I was looking at the wrong side. Yes, so it's going to rise, and what we're looking for. The NG should be stabilized, which it now is, so we are free to bring the fuel lever to 100% forward, and that engine is going to spool up. Is the generator on? It shouldn't be. Switch it off. Yeah, whoops. Right, okay, so we'll keep the generators off for now. Anyway, so it spools up and spools back down again. Once it's all stabilized, which it now is, we will take the starting switch off. And we're now going to do the same for the left engine. So left engine on. NG should come up, oil pressure should come up. Engine now stable, oil pressure now just about stable, so let's bring this back forward. Okay, so engine spooling up. Then down, and back up, and it should stabilize around about 55,000 RPM. Okay, so it'll just take a little minute for that to stabilize, but it's now at an acceptable point that we can switch that off, so... Righty, what is next on the checklist? Did I put this? Yes, okay, I did. Right, that's fine. So, power levers should now go to the full idle position. I can reverse these engines, which is why I have the option of doing this. Sorry, that's why it looks like they're in the middle. But actually, this is zero. So, now we put our generators on. So, they're in the on position. And we have good DC load, which is fine. Compass is fine, we're level with a slight nose down. Engine instruments are stable. Caution lights, we don't have any on. Altimeter, I set the altimeter clock. Yes, that's about right. Perfect. Okay. So, altimeter and clock. Anti-collision and position lights. Nope, I'm looking at the wrong side. Yes, I'm looking for these two. So anti-collision lights on, position lights on. And we have our permission to taxi, so I'm just going to... Ordinarily, we would be dealing with, like, retarded ATC, but unfortunately, we have to deal with retarded ATC. So I'm just going to use cheat mode, i.e. external cameras, to check and make sure that I'm not going to be here. Let's go back inside. Let me... ground. Okay, he's been told to get off the runway, but he's not been told where he's going yet, which is a bit annoying.
Tower, beach, golf, November, Kilo, Kilo, golf, ready to copy, IFR, clearance, echo, golf,
right, okay,
number,
let's
echo.
Get the taxi lights on. So, I'm only doing this because this is parked horribly, I'm going to do a little bit of cheat mode, just so I don't accidentally crash into the hangar, because it is absolutely no fun ending a flight before it has even started. So, get ourselves as close as we can. Yeah, that's fine. And we're just going to turn this around. I think he's going to...
Ground, beach, golf, November, Kilo, Kilo, golf, ready to taxi,
IFR. Okay, let's push back.
Kilo, Kilo, golf, taxi 2 and short of runway 26, via taxiway.
So we're going to be in a bit of a queue while we wait for him, so actually...
Taxi, short runway 26, using taxiway, Bravo, beach, Kilo, Kilo, golf.
While he is doing his thing, in fact, tell you what, it is getting a bit dark, so I'm going to put the instrument lights on.
Okay.
So while we're waiting for him to get out of the way, I'm going to put the handbrake on and I'm going to do another set of checks. So. Power levers, we're going to put them back into the feathered position. Warning light reset props should be on, which it is, so bring them full forward. And that's fine. So now we're going to bring the engines up a little bit. Beta lights come off, bring it back. Beta lights come on, which is fine. Auto feather should be armed, which it is. And anti-ice, we don't need it, it's 10 degrees. Yeah, we should put it on. Generally speaking, in this aircraft, reading in the manual, you should have the anti-ice on if you're going to be flying under 10 degrees, just in case, because obviously the freezing point of water is zero, but with impurities, it is not necessarily always zero. Okay, so we're going to bring this up to the taxi line. Oops, that's a bit fast. Okay, so we have off center line. That's fine. So we've now asked for permission to take off, which is fine. We're not going to get it, obviously, because there's a nice King Air aircraft on the runway. And I need to acknowledge that message. And I can't. Okay, here we go. So we've now been told position and hold. Acknowledge. Oh no, I can't. You're going to see this quite a lot through the flight. What happens is if you have the ATC window down, And it messages you. You can't reply to it by pressing a number. You've got to close it and bring it back up. And it's a bit tedious, but it's what needs to be done. So while we are taxiing into position, I'm going to bring the flaps down ready for takeoff. I didn't actually go through it on the checklist, even though I've done it. Check, make sure that the flight controls are free. And again, this is a tight turn, so engage cheat mode. Yes, all flight controls are free and functioning, and we've got good movement in steering column and whatnot. That's fine, I've hit the wrong button. That's just going to soon. We will wait for that king here. Okay. Okay, so acknowledge takeoff clearance. Here we go! So this is quite a short runway, so I'm going to hold it on the brakes, bring the engines up to about 60%, let them come up, which they're now up. So I've now released the brakes and we're now at 100% acceleration for takeoff.
V1
called.
Rotate.
So, positive rate of flight. This is a fixed gear aircraft, so I have no need to raise my gear. What speed are we at? Yeah, we're gonna hold the climb like this. I'm gonna bring up this little thing. Yes, we should deal with that. I want to bring this up. So we're now going to go and set this to 10,000 feet. Oops. 10,000 feet. Yes, I heard your last transmission. Okay, so we've got good rate of climb, and that aircraft is now flying on autopilot, and I'm going to bring us off of 100% throttle, because that's not recommended to leave it on. And let us tune Glasgow Approach, so let's talk to Glasgow Approach. So weather today is generally quite nice actually. It's clear, wind isn't too strong, and we have a bit of haze. That's fine. Right, so, I just realised, I don't think I've told you about our destination for this flight. We've got a little bit of turbulence, so the passengers are, of course, hurting themselves a little bit. Okay, so we are flying from Cumbernauld, which is actually my old home in the central belt of Scotland, over to Campbeltown Airport, otherwise known as RAF Macrahanish. Formerly known as RAF Macrahanish. It's no longer an RAF base, although I do believe it is used by the MOD occasionally. So now that we're off, let us auto-feather off, landing lights off, also a taxi light. Taxi light is now off, obviously we don't need that while flying, and yeah. Oh no, wait, I've turned down the landing lights, they need to be on. I switched them on and off using the keyboard shortcut, but I forget that until I'm at 6,000 feet in the United Kingdom, they need to be switched on. So yes, we're flying from Cumbernauld to Campbeltown Airport. The reason for that is because Campbeltown Airport has one of the longest runways in the UK, and I'm probably going to need it for a landing because, like I said, it has been almost 2 years since I've done a flight in flight sim. So the longer the runway, the better. Let's turn the displays on for those that really need them, but yeah. Okay, so directly ahead of us is Glasgow Airport. So this is a navigation point for us. Basically, we'll be hitting Glasgow Airport, and then we'll be heading pretty much just down over this way for a little bit before turning to land at our airport. The nice thing about the way the wind's blowing is we are taking off and landing in basically a straight line, whereas if the winds were in the other direction, we would need to take off, fly over Edinburgh, turn, fly back past Glasgow, past the airport, and then circle round, and then back to the land. Okay, we're picking up a little bit of speed now, so let's increase the rate of climb, 5 meters per second. So yes. It's literally the difference between your flight's going to take about, 35, 40 minutes or an hour and 10 minutes, because it practically, it almost doubles the distance that you have to fly, particularly with ATC vector, the length of thing that it is. Plan turning everything, the prop de-ice is on, so we're almost at 0 degrees, so that's fine. So, let's talk a little bit about mods and add-ons and such. What you're seeing down here, in fact we're passing over Glasgow city centre, you can see some of the landmarks that come with the scenery. You've got your SECC, the BBC building, you have here the Glasgow Science Museum exhibit. You've got the big tower that comes with it, and the IMAX theatre. I don't believe it's modelled in this, but this here, the river park, which I'm trying to look at, is very difficult. This is actually a seaplane airport in real life. Right, traffic 4 o'clock. I hit the wrong button. Cancel.
Transition altitude, Captain.
Okay, transition altitude, which means I can yank off, please. I can't see no dash. If I had easier controls, I would just move to see it, but instead I am going to cheat. So that's the dash. It's on approach to Glasgow Airport, so let's start. Ordered him inside. How we doing for speed? Reasonable. Fine. Excellent. Right, so let's get rid of the ATC for the moment. Yes, so the airport we took off from was Cumbernauld Airport. The scenery there was brought to you by UK2000, which I use for some of the airports. The scenery that you saw from Glasgow City Centre, including our destination airport, which is Campbeltown Airport, is provided by Scotflight scenery, which is quite nice because it adds an absolute ton of airports, and it does them to a reasonably good depiction of real life, which is really nice, because particularly if you're a GA flyer, which I'm not really, but still, you're quite like this. Because for some reason or other, Microsoft tends to think that Scotland becomes a desert this time of the year. I had to install a default scenery replacer, so that just replaces the textures. That is called FSX, and that's stuff like the ground textures that you see. Just replaces autogen and stuff like that. So my passengers are really getting thrown around in this wind. We're probably not going to get much time to have the seatbelts off, because passengers generally don't like it if you're if their seatbelts are off and they're getting tossed about the place. So we're now going to think ahead to landing. It's a bit early, but it's important that we actually do it. So I'm going to set my automatic direction finder, the ADF, to the Macrahanish omnidirectional beacon, which is a frequency of 380 Hz. So when we get range, this little dial here will start pointing to the direction of the airport. Now, under the assumption that the winds are still reasonably the same, that's a bit of a flaw. Like, there's a star in front of the moon. that's funny. Yes, if that's what I can do. Seeing as we're let's turn the interior lights on. The passengers look happy. Why are we now to 9,000 feet? So assuming the winds stay the same, let's zoom in a little bit. If I had my track IR working, I could just actually zoom in towards the screen. The runway at Campbeltown Airport is, if I am not mistaken, 290. Runway 29 is where we'll be landing. So I have set... So I've set this to 290 degrees, which is fine. We won't really need this because the airport doesn't have ILS, but what it does let us do is it lets us easily keep track of the direction of the runway should we need to do a go-around and join into the circuit.
Passing 10,000 feet.
So we're at 10,000 feet, so speed's going to come down. Okay, so apparently they wanted us to contact Scottish Centre, and we've gone right back to Glasgow Approach, but such is the wonderful way of ATC in this here flight simulator. Phew. At least we're getting a nice view of the sunset. And Scotland, in all its glory. So, where we are heading, we'll be passing over this island, and we are heading approximately, see that little band? I'm using my binoculars here. In fact, you can almost see the start of the airport. This little sandbank here is the start of your approach line. It's a little bit of a kind of nook. I'm actually using my hands, I'm forgetting I can't see them because it's doing a sort of screen recording. What's now just behind that sudden cloud, this is the airport of which we are going to be landing at. So this isn't just a willy-nilly little flight. I did put planning into this, obviously, as you can tell by the fact that I told you that I picked it because it's got a nice long runway. Along the way there are three potential emergency airports for us to land at. The first one we've now already passed over, which was Glasgow Airport. Off to our left is Glasgow Prestwick Airport, which is another it's another possible airport to land at if should need arise, and if something was a drastic emergency to happen right about now. There's actually a grass airstrip. Let me zoom in. I think it's around. Yeah, okay, it's
so we can just make out the last grass airstrip, which is a very short runway landing.
Yeah,
grass.
10,000 feet.
But it would do the trick if we physically could not get to any other airport. So yes, quite aware. So we're now descending to 3,100 feet, and we've been asked to expedite and actually have to start. Because we are very soon going to be descending below the transition altitude, I'm just going to switch the limits on now, and speed's climbing up with us being in descent, so I am going to retard the throttle down to flight idle. So we have approximately 13 minutes to fly to Campbeltown Airport. So we're basically going to go over the bottom of this island, turn into the sandbank, which is roughly where I'm frantically waving that mouse in the air at you. Oh yeah. My joystick, it actually has built-in stopping points around about flight idle and around about 80% thrust, which is actually quite good for getting in your throttle quickly into the flight idle position. The only problem is it's not particularly consistent, so you do tend to see a little bit of, you can just make it out, you can see the throttle shaking backwards and forwards. That is a bit of a feature. Right, let's get rid of this. Okay, so the air pressure has changed. So let's change that.
Altimeter 1020, set and check.
I just realized something. My friends that know me know that I like to fly airliners quite a lot. It has been a very, very long time since I have flown a fully manual landing, which is what I'll be doing. I'm just re-entering that because I wasn't 100% sure that I hit the right keys. Yeah, so this is actually going to be pretty interesting. It has been a very long time since I have done that. So I don't practice it. I don't do a lot of practice. Even when I was flight simming a lot, I never really practiced. Manual landings all that often. So let's have a look. Oh wow, we're very much in the pea soup. You know what, this is going to be very, very uncomfortable if this turns out to be a dense, fat, and patch of fog.
We're passing transition altitude, Captain.
Nope, it's just a cloud, and the light animations aren't working. Okay, fine. Ah yes, so the direction finder has now found the airport, basically flying directly into it, which means we're going to have to swerve a little bit to the left and hook back off to Yeah, it would be interesting. Traffic at 3 o'clock, 4 miles, 2,008 trips. Nope, don't see it. Jeep mode! Still don't see it. Oh, there it is. Flying over the press. Okay, so let's get rid of that. I'm quite sure 100% what's going on here. some fog map. Right, anyway. So what we need to watch for is when the autopilot takes us to the correct altitude, we're going to level out, in which case, at which point, I need to increase the speed. I did apologize for the slight texture problems. I'm not really sure 100% what's going on. I'm sure it's got something to do with the fact that there is a haze. And as you get close, the haze is trying to wear out, but it's just binary that there either is haze or isn't. Yes, I can see that blowing this time. Yeah, so I assume it's kind of binary, it either switches on or off, and that's kind of the boundary is what we are seeing here, so bark, bark, bark. Anyway, it doesn't matter, we're going to be landing soon. Okay, so we're leveling now, so let's bring the throttles back up. Throttle's about 70%. I am just looking at the kneeboard because I have specifically what I was looking for was the auto feather. I know you have it on for takeoff, but do you have it on for landing? The checklist. Another thing you should probably talk about a bit more is FS Passengers. This does have failures built into it, so at any point, and for my airline, I've set the failures at 10%. So at any point during this flight, we are at a 10% risk of having a failure of some description. In fact, like I said, it can range from anything from hydraulics failure, engine failure, all the way down to little things that you might not even notice. So that's why it's pretty good. You should always do it when you're flying anyway, it's not that important for sim flying, so obviously it's not real life. But with FS Passengers, it is quite important to keep constantly looking for your engines, because that will let you know if something is imminently going to go tits up. More turbulence. No, and speaking of mods, I forgot to say, weather is provided to you somewhat probably, by Active Sky Next. Okay, so we're still heading over towards the sandbank, which is down there. And we've not seen a great deal of traffic during this flight so far, but the traffic is provided by Traffic 360. It's not off. Okay. So we're going to speak to other people's. Contact Scottish Centre. No change in altimeter settings. So we're basically going to fly like this with the passengers in complete terror. Stick on here.
Heading 2-0, and check.
So this is basically just now trying to get us to line up with the runway. As soon as we pass this island, probably, or maybe a couple minutes after, we are going to get our landing clearance. Struggle to cope with. Shut up, passengers. So I'm looking at the traffic map as well. Let's actually let me zoom out to that. So there are two aircraft in our area. There's that one here which is heading towards us, and there's a plane which is it's a general aviation plane. And that's gonna pass behind us. Of course, you just have to take my word for it. you can't see the second screen I have, which has my map of all the traffic and just a general map in general. I can feel that sentence. Yeah, it like so much better than the default thing. And you also can't see it because my recording software is set to show what is on. It shows this FSX window where sitting on top of it I also have my route information, which is currently telling me that we have 5 minutes at this speed to our destination. Of course, we'll actually be slowing down as we start a descent, because if I were to put full flaps down now, I would probably end up backwards underwater on fire. So we're almost 90 degrees. Instruction. Okay, so we're now going to. Oops, that's wrong. Let's bring that one. So we're going to descend down into 2000. So this is really going to be the start of our final approach into. I can't tell if this aircraft is going to be landing with us. Given that we are going to be starting our final approach soon, and I will forget otherwise, I am going to switch the interior lights off. Because I will forget, and I will wonder why I can't see a damn thing. Okay, they want us to expedite our descent. So I'm just going to slow the engines up a little bit. So you will notice this in situations when you're flying, you will notice the lights in the cabin go off for takeoff and landing. That's just to increase visibility for the pilots, because if you were to fly into a cloud with all your lights on, all that light is going to reflect off of all that light is going to reflect off of clouds, and you're not going to see a damn thing. Aha, right, okay. So
heading 2957, check.
So, let us use our little wonderful magic binoculars, and we can indeed see the runway. It's slightly behind the haze, but we can see it. So, let me speak to the controller man. Okay. I know in real life that this isn't an advisory. I know this for a fact because I've been in the Campbeltown Airport control tower. Okay, so... So what we're going to do at the moment, looking ahead, I can see that we have two red lights. I am going to zoom in so I can show you this. If you have stuck around with this video, you can barely see it. Yeah, if you've stuck around with this video thus far, you probably know that the... I can never remember if they're called Fazzies or Pappies. I can't remember if they're actually different or what have you. I am not a professional ear person. However, the objective is to have sometimes there's four big airports, in this case it's only two, so the objective is to have one white and one red, which is the case now. If you have two white, it means you are too high, and if you have two red, it means you are too low. So, because we are on, it's called the glide slope when you're on the right, so I'm going to start the descent now. So I am about the appropriate glide slope, I think, is around about 500 feet. So I am going to... Shut up, passengers. Okay, so I'm going to bring the engines up. The descent rate, and the reason I'm doing this is just because I am slowly extending the flaps. We are now at full flaps. In fact, this is a really long runway, so we'll just do 30 flaps. And so we're sinking a bit fast, so we're going to try and keep it at around 500 feet per minute descent. We're a little bit too far to the left. I got rid of the autopilot screen because, as you might have heard by the beeping, I am now in full manual control of this aircraft, which is a position I have not been in a very, very long time for landing. Okay. So I don't want to risk going too low. We're in close now, so because this is our traffic route, and so we are on finals. So that tells anyone who might be driving, that might be taxiing around the airports, that we are coming in. We do intend to land and to keep the F off my runway. So we're going to keep descending like this. Okay, he's behind us. So he's just joined the advisory channel, so I will do another message to remind him the fact that I'm here, I'm in front of him, just in case. I have all my lights shining, so hopefully he can see me, but just in case. Okay, so we're now just managing this. We are still a little bit to the left, that's not bad. We're 500 feet. Oops.
400.
400 feet. Bring it back up. One glide slip.
Approaching minimums.
Bring us round to the left again. So we're approaching minimums, which is the point at which we decide if we're going to land or not. The decision will be to land when we
are here.
And minimum has been called, so we are deciding that we're going to land, which is fine. So I'm just going to start slowing us up a little bit. A little bit more, we're about 90 knots. 100 feet. Why not? I'm just going to...
50, 40, 30.
Okay. Just
20.
Minutes.
10.
landing! Us down. Now, the reason why normally you would stick rigidly to the center line of the runway. I did do a quick little test just before I started this, just to make sure all the controls were working, obviously. And I did notice that for some reason or other, in all my aircraft, the left landing gear didn't register when you hit the ground. I wasn't sure if that was just for default aircraft or not, so I just figured I'd have a go at this. But I could feel it as I hit the ground, and you could probably see the aircraft rotated very slightly to the left. So I just decided we've got plenty of space on the runway, let's just run with it, prevent the aircraft from tipping over, which is what happened in my test flight. So... oh, the truth is, I also assumed it just wasn't because of a particularly, so that lets people know that we are clear. So yeah, if it was a short runway, we would be using reverse thrust and heavy brakes. Actually, I just let that roll to a close, because like I say, I could feel the left side dipping, and I didn't want to use too much control input. If I was getting our landing lights off. Okay, because we don't need them. And now that we're on the ground, let us... crap, what's the button? Menu! FS Passengers. FS Passenger Flight. Ah, it does not have it anymore! Okay, it's annoying. Anyway, never mind. Sorry, I was a bit distracted by that. I know with FS Passengers 2004, you could play music to kind of liven up your people's experience. You used to be able to do Control-Shift-T and it would play music, but no, apparently I'm not getting no music from my passengers. So, yes, this is us now on the ground. We're actually remarkably, by the time we park up, we're going to be almost precisely on time for a 50-minute flight, not including the several minutes that I spent having locked my passengers outside. So yes, I quite clearly need to work out a couple of things, such as those texture issues and why on earth my left gear seems to collapse only during takeoff. It's on landing, because it seems after landing, obviously you can tell that, well, yeah, we've not sank in the ground any, so clearly the gear hasn't actually collapsed, or it's not simulated to have collapsed. So there just seems to be a little bug on landing that I need to sort out. But anyway, all my passengers are here, we're all safe, we landed on time, and 97% satisfaction, because turbulence is a little bit cheap. So we are going to go to parking. There are several parking facilities, but I do indeed believe this is actually Campbeltown Airport. The one that we are going to here, whereas the other side is the Macrahanish side of things. Yeah, that's the airport terminal. Oh, come to think of it, it could just be in big aircraft that has the ability to play music, because we don't exactly have a PA system in this thing. I mean, the door is open, you can pretty much just yell to your passengers if you need to. Ordinarily you would have the controllers tell you where to go, but given that there's no controllers, because this mistakenly believes... in fact, that's a little bit broken. Yes, let us go to... this. Okay, so... I'm just trying to work out which place is free. So unlike Cumbernauld Airport, which was just a quick taxi, this is quite a long taxi because obviously, like I said, it's quite a big facility. In fact, this airport back when the space shuttle program was open was one of only two, I think, airports in the entire UK that was large enough to facilitate the space shuttle should the need for an emergency re-entry occur. So we are going to stop at the T, which is about here. Excellent! Right, so we are going to put parking brakes on. Taxi lights are off because we don't need them. Let us fasten seatbelt signs, so we will look at that exactly on time. You don't get that from aviation all that much. Okay, so I remember the shutdown check being very simple. Power levers are flight idle, not complete idle, so we'll bring them back up a little bit. Propeller levers now to the feathered position, which is fine. Generators are now... Where's that? There. Generators off, fuel levers off. So that's the engines now off. Fuel boost switches off. And what else? Light switches are off, and then we turn the battery and avionics off. So now the engines are... I'm not going to open the doors until they've completely spun down, because that would be a bad idea. In fact, I remember when I was doing some flying exercises from RAF Kirknewton, there's a wonderful sign there which is just a blood splatter with some googly eyes coming out of it, and the caption is, "Propellers are the cutting edge of technology, so remember to keep ahead," which is just shocking. Right, anyway, engines are now off. So the doors are open so that me passengers can disembark. Final things that we need to do, switch off the lighting switches, also de-icers, they can go off now, we don't need those. So strobe lights, don't need those on, don't need the beacon on because the engines are off, no smoking sign, I'll just keep it on because there's never a point where smoking is going to be okay on this aircraft of mine.
Echo Charlie traffic,
Piper's off, Mike Julia. So, avionics master off, and battery switch now off. And the final thing on the checklist is, if last flight of the day, if yes, take beer. So, I don't quite have a beer, but I have a cider, so yay! Yeah, so we've got another 19 seconds until the passengers get off of my plane. And then afterwards, this flight will be concluded. So this is a first for my channel. Thank you very much for joining me on this flight. And I hope you've enjoyed it. And I hope you will join me next time. I really hope to get back into this because it has been so long since I've done flight simming. So yes, I hope to make this a regular feature in my gaming career. I might not always do videos of them because they are quite long, and I dread to think what the rendering time is going to be on this. But nevertheless, it is great fun, so thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you later. Bye! You probably won't be able to see this. Yeah, you definitely can't see it. I'm looking at the recording window just now. My rating was perfect. let's have a look at what it says. Our landing touchdown speed was nice, which is good. we didn't do any services because we don't have them. Right, let's look at the pilot points. You made a very nice landing, 50 points. Perfect flight, no problems, and satisfied passengers. 150 points. You landed at the scheduled airport, 30 points.
precise arrival time at destination, I was 23 seconds off being exact, and I landed the aircraft with the turbulence, which the passengers were very happy at. So, that's been a relatively good flight, so yay! And this is the real end of the video, so thank you very much for watching. Bye.